celebrate the Rosh Chodesh the right way, we have to say some words of Torah, and later on we can say Birkat Hamazon. So before the meal, we spoke a little bit about the tikkun that we need to do. This is not a recommendation, rather something we need to do in the month of Tammuz. But nevertheless, we want to also focus on what is the power, so to say, of the month. And as we said many times, every month has a certain quality, a certain a unique energy. And I need to know and to be aware of what is this unique quality of the month, so I can actually benefit from it and focus on it. So the month that we're starting now is the month of Tammuz. What is interesting is that the names of the months are not biblical. They're not coming from the Torah. And actually, the names of the months, they came back with, they brought these names from Babel. That's not biblical. In the Torah, it says Chodesh HaRishon, the first month, Chodesh HaShvi'i, the seventh month. The actual names, Av, Tammuz, Tishrei, and so forth, they brought the names with them back from Babel. So some of the names don't have good meaning. For example, Tammuz is a name of idolatry. It was one of the idols, and there was a certain avodah zarah. So nevertheless, interestingly, that every month the name that it got is somehow connected a little bit to the root and the essence of the month. And like we learned in the class before, where I explained that every month there's a certain combination of the letters of Yud Kei Vav Kei. Every month the order of the letters change. And happens to be on the month of Tammuz, the order of the letters Yud Kei Vav Kei is completely opposite. It's the other way around. It's Hey and then a Vav, and then a Hey and then a Yud. It's completely turned over, where we explained that the whole month is just an order of Din, of judgments, instead of, for example, the right order on Nisan, Yud Kei Vav Kei, which is complete Rachamim, 100% Rachamim, Chamim Gmurim. But nevertheless, in the order of the months, then Tammuz is the fourth month, and that's when we count from Nisan. Some people count from Tishrei. Interestingly, the Bnei Sakhar, in many times, he is counting from Tishrei and not from Nisan. But counting from Nisan is the fourth month. Based on the Book of Formation, Sefer Yetzirah, some people call it the Book of Creation. Nevertheless, the Hebrew is the more precise one. It's Sefer Yetzirah. So we know there that every month is created with a certain letter. So the month of Tammuz is created with the letter Chet, and the month of Av is created with the letter Tet, which when you put them together one after the other, it's Chet. It's Chet, and then the letter Tet. All you're missing the Aleph is that it's the word Chet, Sin, Mamash. So you see that the months of Tish Tammuz and Av, it falls on the 3 weeks. The 3 weeks fall, some in Tammuz, some in Av, the sin of the Meraglim and many other things. So mamash, we see that even the letters of the 2 months together, they form the word Chet. Not the letter Chet, rather Chet and Tet. All is missing is the Aleph, and you have the letter Sin. So it's a very sensitive time. Now the Midrash explains that when Yaakov and Esav were fighting, you remember the famous story, then the angels of Yaakov and Esav were fighting. The Midrash says that the angels of Esav, they took the month of Tammuz and Av from Yaakov. And Yaakov continued fighting, and Yaakov was able to take back a little bit of Tammuz and a little bit of Av. So Yaakov took the beginning of Tammuz and the end of Av, and Esav stayed with the middle of Tammuz and the beginning of Av. That's why we see that the first half of Tammuz is okay, it's good. The second half of Tammuz is already after Yudzan B'Tammuz, it's bad. The first part of Av is bad, and the second part of Av after Tu B'Av, it's already good. So the Midrash says, as the result of the fight between Esav and Yaakov, Esav was able to snatch, so to say, to take Tammuz and Av, but Yaakov was able to save the beginning and the end of Tammuz and Av. And needless to say that the 3 weeks in between, these are the 3 weeks that Esav is holding, and of course we know that from Yud Zayin Tammuz to Yud Be'av. This is not the best time for the Jews, and we minimize joyous occasions, we minimize anything that can be involved in danger and traveling and so forth, and we take this time to swimming, anything that can be involved in danger, that hiking, swimming, running, whatever it is, because this is not a good time. It happens to be that this year I'm going to be traveling to the United States, and it happened a few times also. And some people test that's when you travel. So first of all, for me, going to the States, it's actually the best time, because there's nothing going on. There's no weddings, there's no simchas, so it's a time that everybody can focus on Torah. But nevertheless, the Talmud says, Shluch mitzvah no nizok. If a person goes to do a mitzvah, then he's guarded by the mitzvah itself. So it happens to be that usually these are the 3 weeks that I actually take advantage of the fact all the big halls or synagogues that we wanted to book, they don't have any simcha, so it's easy to book a synagogue for a big lecture and everybody comes because there's nothing to do. So, but nevertheless, this is a 3 weeks that you want to kind of keep it low. Not too good to travel, not too good to put yourself in danger and anything. Nevertheless, since the Midrash is talking about the fight between Esav and Yaakov, what does that hint to us? If there's a fight, it means you're fighting over something valuable. You don't fight over nonsense. Unfortunately, many people will fight over nonsense. But usually when there's something, there's a fight, means there's a cause, there's something important that you're fighting over. So if Yaakov and Esav were fighting, because technically, Yaakov could have been a mensch and say, you know, take whatever you want, just leave me alone. Well, I don't want to get into a confrontation. Yeah, Yaakov was not into a confrontation. But Yaakov put up a struggle and a fight. Must be that he was fighting to defend something or to something very important. So the book of Yetzirah, the Sefer Yetzirah, says, like I said before, that every month has a letter that created it, every month has a planet that is overseeing and controlling it or funneling the energy through the planet. Every month through the zodiac has a sign. So Tammuz, we know, is Sartan, cancer. We just said the letter is Chet. But nevertheless, we also learn every month that every month has a certain sense, a chush. Now we are more familiar with five senses, but really there are 12 senses. And every month, when we do our month class, we talk about the sense and we talk about the tribe. So there's always a tribe that is connected to the month, and there's always a sense that is connected to the month. The sense that is connected to the month of Tammuz is the chush ha-re'iyah, the sense of seeing. And the tribe that is connected to the month is Reuven, which in Reuven there's already the shorish, the root of Re'iyah, Re'eh. So this is a month that I can use my sight, my eyesight, my Re'iyah, either for something positive or something negative. We just talked about before that the whole point is Re'ayin Tovatz, you have to see good things. Now, every month also has a tribe that is connected to the month, and they don't go in a certain order. There's also a question, how do we know which month is connected to which tribe? So the way that we know is the way how they went in order in the desert. They weren't walking like a mess, it was organized. So, for example, Yehuda was the first tribe that was going in the front. So Yehuda is connected to the month of Nisan. That's the first month. He was the first tribe. Look at the order, the Bnei Sakhar. He's talking about it. He explains that the order how they went in the desert, that's how it separated into the months. So, excuse me. So the month of Nisan is the first month. Yehuda was the tribe that was going in the head. So the month of Nisan corresponds to, connected to Yehuda. The month of Tammuz is connected to Reuven. Reuven was fourth in line going in the desert. So we always see a connection between the tribe, the essence of the tribe, the root of the name of the tribe, and the sense of the month. So we all concluded in the same thing in the month of Tammuz, that it's all about the chush ha-re'iyah. And in the previous class we were talking about that the gave the explanation more in depth about the sefirot, how there are two ways of looking at the sefirot. One way is called sefirot igulim. This is explained in Talmud Eser HaSefirot of Rabbi Ashlag. In the first and the second part, he says there's two ways how the Kadosh Baruch Hu is governing the world. And in both ways, it's through the Sefirot, the 10 emanations. But one way, when it's coming in a sfirot bekav yashar, in a straight line, that means there's an hierarchy, there's one on top of the other. This is the corresponding to now. This is what's called the Zman of the Tikkun, one when we're still doing the rectification. And there's also the Sfirot that are coming in Sfirot Igulim, that's coming in a form of a circle, and this is for Gemara Tikkun, after the Tikkun. But we gave more explanations in the class before, I don't want to repeat myself. But we mentioned that the month of Nisan, of Tammuz, always going to fall very close to the Parasha of Korach. We read Korach last week, in the diaspora they're reading Korach this week, falls exactly on Rosh Chodesh Tamuz. But nevertheless, even with or without the leap year, Tamuz and Korach will always fall around the same time. We spoke about it in the class before, and we mentioned that Korach really, what was his mistake? That he had what's called the Ein Tzara, narrow eye, but the translation to Ein Tzara is not narrow eye. Ein Tzara means very jealous and stingy, and why him, and why he has what I don't have. That's Korach. He was jealous. At the end of the day, Korach was jealous. The jealousy started an argument and came into machloket, to a disagreement and a lashon hara. But nevertheless, it says that what caused Korach to sin is that his eye was tricking him, was misleading him. Eino hita'ato. That was his problem. But we explained more in length in the class before how he already saw the Gemara Tikkun. He already saw how the Hanaga, the governing of the world, has already been a form of a igul that everybody is equal. And everybody is the same way. We're all getting the same Shefa. And that's why he came to Moshe and says, Kol Eidak Dushim, we're all equal. Why do you think you're better? Nevertheless, it wasn't the right time. But what's interesting here is when the text says that his eye, what was tricking him, because he looked into the future, he had Ruach HaKodesh, he saw his son's great tzaddikim, Bnei Korach, he saw Shmuel Anavi coming from his lineage, he says, well, of course, I'm on the top of the chain. But nevertheless, his eye tricked him, so to say, and he just didn't see it in the right time, and he went against Gdol Ador, the rabbi of the generation, which is Moshe Rabbeinu, of course. But what do we take from that? That when the text is saying that his eye tricked him, we spoke about it before, that the only organ or limb in the body that is round is the eye. Nothing else is round. The eye is a perfect circle. So the eye is a very powerful tool that in Tammuz I can fail by looking through the tool of the eye at the world in a very negative way. That will cause jealousy. That will cause animosity and hate, and exactly what we spoke about a minute ago. If he's doing something good, I have to bother them in some way or another. And you would think, well, why am I bothering you? What am I doing? I'm doing something good. Why do you have to go against me? So this Ein Tzara, that somebody is doing something good for the benefit of others, and somebody doesn't like that. This is not a good midah. The right midah is Ein Tova. You look at things and you judge things favorably. It's very easy to look at a person, see how he behaves and says, look at him. Which of course, that's coming from a very low place, that I'm very judgmental. So in the month of Tammuz, I'm actually very easily can fail in Mar'it Ayin. There is a term in Halakha that some things they're not prohibited in doing, but we don't do it because somebody can look and they can interpret it the wrong way. It's called Mar'it Ayin.
Right.
Yeah? 100%? I'll give you a different example. Not too long ago, you allowed, just for the sake of the example, you allowed to start a machine to work before Shabbat and let it go into Shabbat. But, for example, you can start a washing machine before Shabbat. There's no problem, there's no prohibition. But what's going to happen if somebody walks into your home and sees the washing machine or the dishwasher working? What? You're working the dishwasher in the middle of Shabbat or the machine? So for Mar'it Ayin, you can't do that. I'll give you an example. Not too long ago, our laundry room, we had a lot of laundry, whatever. So it was maybe half an hour before Shabbat, so we could have put the laundry in the dryer. But the problem is, there's a big window in the laundry room. My house is right over here. Anybody that would pass would hear the dryer making noise. You know, the dryer, all the thing makes noise there. All you need is a little buckle. And And I was like, we can't do that, because any person that will walk through the house, what the rabbi is having is his dryer working on Shabbat. So the action is not prohibited, but somebody can look, and it doesn't look like the right way, then marita ayin, don't do it. Like you said now, almond milk, many other things, there's many other things that you don't do because marita ayin. The eye is a very sensitive tool. Even as an organ, it's a very sensitive, the eye is not really an organ, part of the body, but sensitive. Yeah, it's called an organ?
It's an organ.
So, but nevertheless, you get a little smack on the hand, on the leg, doesn't, the eye, it's so sensitive that something so small as dust will affect the eye. So we see the hint, what was Yaakov was fighting on so much, is the fact that we are subject to whatever we see. And unfortunately, our system is very quick to judge. We see something and right away we judge. And the Torah comes and tells you, don't be quick to judge. Don't look at something and right away come to conclusions. Because you know what? Most of the times you're judging the situation completely wrong. Now, when you judge a situation wrong, then as our sages say in the Talmud, the eye sees, the heart wants, desires, chomed, and then the brain starts thinking, oh, how, what, and who? So the eye has to put a very, very kosher filter on it. That I look at things the right way, I don't judge things that are very quick. I judge things favorably. Maybe he didn't have the right intention, maybe he's in a rush, maybe something's going on. The point is that in the month of Tammuz, we spoke about in the class before, what is the tikkun? Is that everything is good. To look at that everything in my life is good. That's what we concluded the last class, where I was explaining that the tikkuni Zohar is giving us a hint of every month. We said that the combination of the letters of Hashem, Yud Kei Vav Kei, they change every month. And every month there's a certain verse in Tanakh that will hint to us what is the tikkun based on the letters from the combination of the name of Hashem. So for example, we gave an example, the month of Nisan, is the order is Yud and then a Hey and then a Vav and then a Hey. So the tikkuni Zohar teaches us that the Pasuk corresponding is Ismechu Hashamayim V'Tagel Haaretz. Yud and a Hey and a Vav and a Hey. Ismechu Hashamayim V'Tagel Haaretz. And then the Tikkuni Zohar says that the month of Tammuz is the verse that Haman was says that all this is not worth it for me. Kol ze eineno shave bishvili. For me, li. So why Haman had the Ayin Tzara? What's your problem, Mr. Haman? You have money, you have wealth, you have status, you have control, you control, you have everything. What's bothering you that one little Jew is not bowing to you? That for that, he says, Shum davar lo shaveh li. Nothing that is not worth it for me. Same thing with Korach. What's your problem, Korach? You are a gazillionaire. You have political power that half the nation was next to you. Genius in the Torah. It was the Talmid Chacham. It was everything. He had everything. What's your problem that you, I want to be a coin. That's your problem. You want to be a coin. So we want to learn from that. That's the tikkun in the month of Tammuz, that it's all going through Chush HaRe'iyah. The month is Reuven. The sense is Re'iyah. You know, it was questioned in the Mishnah, what is the right way of judging another person? One Tana said, you have to have a Ruach Shvela, and so forth, a low nefesh, be humble, and so forth. One of the Tanaim says, Ayin Tova, look at things in the right way. Don't judge things, your eye can be very misleading. So the tikkun, we want to focus on the month of Tammuz, especially that there's the sensitivity, or very easy to fall into danger. The danger is what's in front of you. You know, many, once they have, if they had the opportunity, they would cover their eyes, I don't want to see anything. We just spoke about yesterday, we're learning from the book of the Chafetz Chaim, of Shmirat HaLashon, and I was mentioning that the Chafetz Chaim had boards on the windows. And he says, if I would look out the window, right away I will fail. I'd rather not look even outside the window. And this is the Chafetz Chaim, not us. So he had boards on the windows. I don't want to look outside. So we also want to put some type of a shield on our eyes that we look at things the right way, and we're not quick to judge. And we look at people in the right way. We look at situations the right way. Something, it's not even how I judge other people. It's sometimes what happens to me. Sometimes something happens to me and I get all upset. Why is it happening? I didn't do anything. This is not fair. This is not good. We start questioning Hashem. But nevertheless, everything that Hashem does It's all good. Kol man derachmana avid letav avid. Whatever Hashem does, He does for the best. So we have to understand that it's all how I look. How they say, it's all in the eyes of the beholder. That's how we say?
Yeah.
It's how I look at things. Yeah, exactly. So the month of Tammuz has the power to transform everything through my eyes, and not only that, to reach to a tikkun, to a rectification. And I want to focus on that, because that's the time when I can actually apply it in the easiest way. It doesn't mean that I'm not going to look at good things good in the month of Tishrei. But now is the month that I can actually do a tikkun, a rectification, to everything that comes through my eyes. Not only emotionally and spiritually, also physically, what I'm looking at. Sometimes we fail severely in what we're looking at. Should not go after our heart. Can't look at things. So some things are mamasha avera. You're not allowed to look at certain things. Things that are immodest or what's called erva, places of filth. But sometimes I can look at a nice car and right away it arouses in me jealousy. Or lachmod, I want this car too. Lo tachmod et eshet re'echa v'et chamorcha et chamorcha. Don't even be jealous of your friend's donkey. And so much more so if it's a Mercedes. But nevertheless, it all is how you look at things and how you perceiving things through the lens. So it all depends how clean the lens are. You want to make sure that your eyes, your lens, the view, the window to the world is clean. And it's covered with good, with positivity, that I can see the world the right way. Even something that is very bad that happens in my life, that I could see the good in it. And like we concluded in the previous class, what is the tikkun? Hakol tov. Everything is good. Everything is good. There's no such a thing. En ra yored min ha-shamayim. Can be that something bad came from Shemayim. If Hashem removed something, or did something, or manipulated something, eventually I don't see it now. I will see how good it is. So since we're in the beginning of the month, we even have an advantage this month, because today really is Lamed of Sivan. We're still not really in Tammuz. I explained before that why we call it Rosh Chodesh. The English is never makes sense. If I go to a restaurant, what do? I make a reservation in advance because I want to have a good seat. I go to a show, I fly overseas, I make a reservation. In Hebrew, this is called Azmana Merosh, ahead of time. This is Rosh Chodesh. Is Merosh, ahead of time, I go into the form of Chodesh, of Hitchadshut, of renewity, of change. So in the middle of the month, okay, it's never too late. But now I have here, I didn't even go into the month of Tammuz. I'm only in Lamed Sivan. Now is the time to make my right decision, my Hachlata. What am I taking on myself this month? Yesterday we had a class in Halakha here. We learned about something very, very simple, and the majority of the class was doing it wrong. The order, how you wake up in the morning, how you say Modeh Ani, when you wash your hands, how you wash your hands, what are you allowed to do? The majority of the people in the class, they got it completely wrong. Something so simple. So instead of having a 45-minute class about many halakhot, we learned one thing, but it was important. So one lady said, good, it's Rosh Chodesh tomorrow, from Rosh Chodesh, that's it. I'm starting to wash my hands next to the bed, not to wash the hands in the bathroom, to say the blessing with my mouth clean, whatever we learn. So Rosh Chodesh is a very auspicious time to take a hachlata, to take a decision. It's a hitchadshut, it's a reset. We have the time to sweeten all the dinim of the month forward. We spoke about it already in the previous class. So now is the time to look at the world in a positive eye. Not to be judgmental, not to be jealous, not to look at somebody else and say, I wish I could do that, I can do that, I want that. That's coming from a place of jealousy and arrogance and weakness. And we see from the past the result, the end result, as we see what happened to Korach. He had everything and then he lost everything. What the Zohar says, Ratza gamal karnaim, chatchu lo ta'oznaim. The camel wanted horns, so they cut his ears off. He looked at the bull, he saw a beautiful bull with beautiful horns. He said, ooh, I want horns. But he doesn't belong to you. Don't want something that doesn't belong to you. And when you desire something that doesn't belong to you and you're going to go after it, not only you're not going to get it, whatever you have will be taken away from you. So that's the result with Korach. Why are you jealous of somebody else? Why do you want something that doesn't belong to you? That's kind of in a very refined way. There's also idol worship. Why are you not happy with what Hashem gives you? You're disagreeing with what Hashem gave you. It's in a very fine line. This is idolatry. So we have to take this opportunity to change our vision to the world and see everything in an Ein Tovah, and to see the good in everything. And every opportunity can be something good. Don't desire, don't lachmod, don't be jealous, don't want. All these don'ts. Why? Look at everything. Be happy for other people. Be happy when somebody else has success. Be happy when somebody else is doing well. Be happy for other people. Work on these midot, then I can guarantee to you that now, the status of Av now in the beginning of Av is not a good time. But nevertheless, we know la'atid lavo, when Mashiach is going to come, these days are going to become the best days. Yemei ha'evel yafu l'simcha. The days of mourning will turn into days of happiness. So if we look at the world in a less judgmental eye, in a more positive way, Bezal Hashem, this year also, the days of Av will turn into a days of simcha, of days of happiness and joy. Bezal Hashem, with our hard effort of looking at the world in a better way and refining ourselves, then we're going to hasten the geula and the redemption, so we can see with our own eyes, with the chezena einenu, that our eyes should see Shuvcha leZion Barachamim, your return to Zion. Zion is the name of Yerushalayim, but with mercy. But it's a goal. All again goes to the eyes. Every day we pray, Techazena Einenu. One can say, no, I want to see the Gula in a different form. No, I want to see it with my eyes. So also to see it with your eyes has to be a tikkun. Bezal Hashem, Hashem should bless us to have a successful month, and a month of happiness and health. Amen. And a month of positivity, that we see things in a positive way. And as the famous Hasidic quote says, if you think good, then it will be good. So if you see good, also will be good. Amen. Bezal Hashem should have a Chodesh Tov.